Okay, thank you, Gabriel, and thank you for the invitation. So I was asked by Tony to give this introductory lecture on semi-classical methods for Langevin dynamics. So I come from a PDE world, and my talk will be mostly on the use of this semi-classical method for these problems. I know that there are many other methods, but I will mostly concentrate on this aspect. So the plan of my talk is the following. So I will briefly introduce the framework, explain the functional space I use to deal with the equation. And then I will spend a long part of my talk on the case of reversible equation, which is the most simple, but where you can already see the features of the approach. So I will explain the relationship with the small eigenvalue value of Witten Laplacian, and explain the general strategy of proof. And at the end of this part, I will give some indication on recent work about boundary value problem that will be certainly discussed in Dorian talk or in Boris poster. And at the end of my talk, I will speak about non-reversible equation. So mostly a Cramer's Fokker-Planck equation and also non-local Fokker-Planck equation, as the one mentioned by Anton Arnold yesterday. Okay, so this is the part that you certainly know. So we let phi be a potential landscape on RD. This could work on a manifold, but I just take phi defined on RD, which will be smooth. And I consider the Langevin equation associated to this landscape, so which are given by this set of equations. So the derivative of the position is given by the velocity, and the derivative of the velocity obeys a deterministic part plus a deterministic part with this friction here plus a noise. Okay. And now if you assume that the mass of the particle is null, then you end up with the overdamped Langevin equation, which is written like this. Okay, so I think everybody knows that here. And now if you adopt a macroscopic point of view, you consider the probability density of presence of a particle satisfying the Langevin equation. So it satisfies this heat equation that I call the Fokker-Planck equation. And in the case of full Langevin dynamics, you end up with a Cramer's Fokker-Planck operator. L is equal to L KHP, which is given by this expression. And in the case of overdamped Langevin, you end up with the Cramer-Smoluchowski operator. Okay. So I put a 2 here because for convenience. Okay, so I will discuss a bit later some fundamental differences between these two operators. And here H, from now on, H will be a small parameter, the semi-classical parameter, which is proportional to the temperature. Okay, so I'm looking at a low temperature limit. Okay, so now the assumption I make on phi are the following. So I suppose that phi is a Morse function, so that it's its session is non-degenerate everywhere, not everywhere, in critical points, sorry. And I assume also some confining hypothesis. So you assume essentially that the gradient phi is bounded from below by a constant here. Phi is big at infinity, so everything here is out of a compact set, and that the Hessian of phi is controlled by the square of the gradient. Okay. So all these assumptions are satisfied by functions which are sub-Gaussian, okay, sub-quadratic, sorry, sub-quadratic at infinity. Okay, so so now you under this assumption you have some global equilibrium for your equation, which are given in the case of Kramers-Fokker-Planck by this expression. So this live in with 2D variables, and in the case of Kramers-Smoluchowski by this Maxwellian. Okay. And you have this M is in the kernel of L in both cases. Okay, and yes, it's, it formally satisfies this equation, and under the assumption of that phi is going to infinity, this M is in any LP, so you you have someone in the kernel. And now, if you under some fairly general assumption, you will have that for t going to infinity, if you start from initial probability distribution u0, then for t going to infinity, exponential minus tl u0 goes to m. And the question that we want to address is what is the speed of convergence in the in this limit? Okay. And since I come from a spectral theory to a community, the way I want to treat this question is proving some spectral gap for L, and even more, describe precisely the spectrum of L. Okay. Okay. So the intuition is anyways guided by the famous paper by Kramers in the 80s. Which tells you that in the case of a double well, the time to go to equilibrium is guided by this rule. So here's so here tau phi is the transition rate from a well to another, and in the case of a double well in 1D, and the important point here is that the S is given by the highest height a particle has to jump over in order to reach equilibrium, and A phi is explicit in terms of derivative of phi. Okay. So. Okay. So now I will look at initial densities which have a special form. So I will assume that u0 is written like the square root of the Maxwellian times someone in L2 of dx. So when I start with such initial densities, then it's natural to conjugate your operator by this unitary operator, so which goes from L2 of m minus 1 dx into L2 of dx, and which sends you on m minus 1 half u. Okay, and so if you do that, what happens? It happens that the dynamic exponential minus TL is exactly given by exponential minus TP, where P is obtained by conjugation of L by your unitary operator. And P has enjoys the following expression. In the case of Kramers-Smoluchowski overdamped Langevin dynamics, you have this simple operator, which is a sort of Schrödinger operator, and in the case of the full Langevin dynamics, so in the case of Kramers-Fokker-Planck operator, you obtain this operator. Okay. So actually, this operator is not only a Schrödinger operator; it is the famous Witten-Laplacian. Okay. So this operator yeah, at least when you look at it on function, was also introduced in by Witten in the 80s to get some topological result. Okay. And of course, when you look at what happens at the evolution, so this quantity, if you use your conjugation, is exactly given by that. So the convergence to the equilibrium M is equivalent to the convergence to square root of M times some factor here. Okay. In this functional space, it's just rephrasing the things in a way that I prefer, especially because now here this operator is self-adjoint on a flat space, and it was self-adjoint on a weighted space before. Okay, so that's what I said. Now that I have conjugated my operator, it is self-adjoint on L2 of dx, and this is the celebrated Witten-Laplacian. And this, but in contrary, the operator P KFP is not self-adjoint on L2. Okay, and this leads to serious complication. So the fact that it is not self-adjoint on L2 is obvious from this expression. You have this part of the operator which is self-adjoint, of course, but this one, since it's of order one here, which is not. Okay. And this is not the only difficulty to analyze the spectrum of this operator. I will explain that there are also some default of ellipticity which enters in the analysis. Okay, but. Anyway, in both cases, we will try to study the spectrum of P in order to get some information on the speed of return to equilibrium. Okay, so what I do...
Check.
Okay, sorry. So I will spend a bit of time to study this operator. So this is a self-adjoint operator. This is a semi-classical Schrödinger operator, but here the potential has a special form. Okay, and it turns out that it also enjoys this nice expression, which comes actually from the initial form of the generator, and. But on this expression, you can already see that this operator delta phi is non-negative, okay? Because this guy here is just the adjoint of this one. Okay. So this operator turns out to be non-negative, which is not obvious from its expression because of this minus h delta phi. And also, it is essentially self-adjoint on a compactly supported smooth function. And so if you want to study the spectrum of this operator, the first thing you have to notice that thanks to our assumptions, so in my assumption, I don't know if you remember, but I suppose that the second derivative of phi were controlled by gradient phi, okay? And this tells you that at infinity, this term is negligible with respect to this one. And also, I suppose that this one was bounded from below. So this tells you that the essential spectrum of your operator is away from zero, away independently of h. Okay. So now I will make a picture of the spectrum. So this is. This is the spectrum of delta phi. Of course, zero is in the spectrum because exponential minus phi over h is in the kernel of delta phi. And here you have C0. And, yes, of course, sorry. Actually, since phi is going to infinity, it's like this. So here you have C0 with some essential spectrum, and here you have eigenvalues that may eventually accumulate here. Okay. But for the return at equilibrium, what is interesting is what happens here near zero. Okay. Okay. So the goal is to know the spectral gap. Okay, so a rough result is the following. So this is due on this written Laplacian to Elfer, Chostrand, and Witten in the 80s. And it tells you that, so you let U zero be the set of minima of phi, and N zero be the number of minima of phi, okay? And it tells you that there exists some epsilon zero strictly positive, such that for H small enough, the spectrum of delta phi in some small window has exactly N zero element. And these N zero small eigenvalues are actually exponentially small with respect to the temperature, okay? Which is in, which is no contradiction with the Ehring-Kramer law.
Local minima,
so the picture is like this now, so you can think of your potential like this, okay, you have a certain number of minima, you count it, so this is a M in U0. Okay. And now, what happens is that if you look at what is the situation in a window of size epsilon H, or epsilon 0, I said, epsilon 0 H, then there is, in this window, there is exactly N0 eigenvalues, and these eigenvalues actually are very, very close to zero. They are all here. So this is exponential minus C over H, and there is nobody here. And after that, there could be some eigenvalues.
Okay.
But they are better than
that. Yeah, yes, they're better. Wait a minute, Laurent, wait a minute, please. Okay?
80s, of course.
Yeah, yeah, of course. But this is introductory. Okay?
Yeah, but
wait a minute. No, no. Okay, I know that this is not your taste, but let me finish, please. Okay? So this is not complicated. How can you see this result? This result is actually totally elementary. You only have, since you are in self-adjoint world, you only have to plug in your operator some approximated eigenfunction. Okay, the min-max principle tells you that once you have a good approximated eigenfunction, then you have exactly the approximated eigenvalues. Okay, so what are the good approximated eigenfunction? They are very simple to construct. Sorry, you know. For this special operator, that exponential minus phi over h is in the kernel of delta phi. Okay, so now how do you construct the so-called quasi-mode? You pick up some cutoff function near. So you have as many cutoff functions that you have minima, and for each minimum m, let's say m here, you take a cutoff function key m, which localized in this well, okay, or near M if you prefer, but you can go as far as you want since you stay in a well, okay. So you take some pickup function, so it has not to go up to the saddle point, so something like that, okay. And now you make this computation. So Laurent, do you feel it's very complicated? So you make this computation, and you see, your operator delta phi, when it goes on this guy, so this guy, so your quasi-mode is just the element of the kernel times the cutoff function, okay? And when you make delta phi of FM0, you compute the commutator of delta phi with your cutoff function, and you also have the case where delta phi goes on this guy, but this guy is in the kernel. So it remains only this expression. And now, where is localized this function? This function, since Qm is equal to 1 just here, this function is localized here. Okay. And what happens here is that in this region, phi of x is much bigger than phi of m, by definition. You are away from the minimum. Okay? So then, this guy here is bounded from below by some constant, and you have delta phi of fm0 is equal to big O of exponential minus c over h. Okay? And this is done for this Worth theorem. And so, of course, what you see here is that if you wonder what is the best constant here, you want to go as high as you can, okay? The higher you can go, the best the constant here is, because it's just given by this different of 8 here, okay?
You assume there are finite number of local minima.
Yes.
The Morse,
this is a Morse function.
Otherwise,
we have the connected components of
the
same logic, and you can also consider a case where there is an infinite number of I will come on this later. This is a review talk, so. Okay, so now the goal is to say something more accurate on these eigenvalues, okay? On the, so I denote lambda 1 to lambda n0, these small eigenvalues, there are n0 small eigenvalues, and I want to compute all of them, okay? Especially the second one, which gives you the spectral gap, but actually, when you want to compute it sharply, you get everything in the same time. Okay, getting some information on these eigenvalues has been done by many people from many communities. So I must mention the large deviation approach by Freundlin and Wenzel, who compute actually this limit, h log of lambda gh. So actually what they compute is exactly this constant c, but they don't say anything on the prefactor, on what is in front of the exponential. Okay? So another approach was by Oli Kuzioka and Strook in the late 80s, who proved that lambda 2 is bounded from below and above by constants times h exponential minus 2 s over h. And here, S is the highest height a particle has to jump in order to reach the absolute minimum of phi. So on my picture here, you have only one absolute minimum, and S is exactly, so assume that this one is just here, this 8. Okay. And this was generalized later by Mathieu and Miklo, who obtained similar bounds for the other small eigenvalues. Okay, I'm not wrong. Okay, so one would like now to actually to compute the exact prefactor. Just not only say this is, we have such bound, but compute exactly what is the sharp constant here. Okay. So this is actually important from a theoretical point of view, but it turns out that it is also important for application. For instance, you have an algorithm developed by Wolter in the late 90s using exactly this prefactor to accelerate dynamics in a metastable simulation. Okay, so this is now quite vague theorem. So, what is it? I claim that there exists a function S which to each minimum associates a number, a height, and such that the n0 small eigenvalues enjoy this expression, an h in front, a certain factor a, which has an asymptotic expansion in powers of h, and exponential minus 2s of m h. Okay? So, which is exactly what we are waiting for. And so this theorem was first proved by Bouvier, Gerhard Klein using some potential theory approach. So they actually don't get exactly this result in all its generality. So they don't have, which is not the most important, they don't have a complete asymptotic expansion, but only the first term of the asymptotic expansion. And they don't treat they have some assumption on what are the family, what is the family of H, S of M. They cannot treat exactly all the minima. Yes?
What's the significance of the zero superscripts?
U0 is for minima. Okay, this is index zero critical point. I also will have a saddle point with index one. Then this theorem was also proved just after by Elfer-Clanier using semi-classical methods, also under a non-degeneracy assumption. And more recently, I proved the result in the full general case. Okay, so if you want to understand this theorem, I have to explain what is this function S from U0 into R plus star. Okay, so what is important in this problem is the labeling procedure. How do you, the construction of this function S, and this goes with this labeling procedure. So I will denote by U1 the set of saddle points of phi, so which are the critical point of index one, okay? So is the saddle point. And for S small enough, I introduce this set, which is, so you look at the sublevel set, the strict sublevel set of phi smaller than phi of S, and you look at this set just near S. So you intersect this set with a small ball, okay? So I claim that this set has exactly two connected components. So I will show you just in a few seconds this in a picture. And I will say that a saddle point S is separating if these two connected components, C1 and C2, are contained in two different connected components of this sublevel set. Okay? So what is the picture? Imagine that you have the level set of a function phi like this. A saddle point S1 here, a saddle point S2 here, a minimum here and here, and here, for instance, here a maximum. On this picture, this saddle point is higher than this one. Okay. So, this is my small ball around S1, and these are the two connected components, C1 and C2. These two connected components. And I claim that this saddle point is not separating because when you look at the set phi smaller than phi of S1, then these two connected components lie in the same connected component of this set. You can go from here to here. If you want to go from here to here, you are not obliged to go through the saddle point, but you can go to another lower saddle point to visit this region. In contrary, if you look at what is the situation in S2, then you still have your two C1, C2, and now you can, if you want to go from here to here, you are obliged to pass through the saddle point S2. Okay, so this is the notion of separating saddle point, and what I will call a separating saddle value is the values of phi in this separating saddle point. Okay, so I denote by sigma this separating sigma, underline sigma, this separating saddle values, and that's all. So so now let me label the minima of phi. Okay, so I will do a picture. So, so let me draw a potential. This is phi. Okay. And the labeling procedure goes as follows. You start from, so you add to your separating saddle value, you add a fictive separating saddle value at infinity, sigma 1, and you look to the set phi smaller than sigma 1, okay, which is, of course, the wall space. And in this connected component, which is the wall space, you pick up, oh yes, I could have done, do that. Okay, let me do that. You pick up a minimum. So on my picture, there is only one, but there could be a more than one absolute minimum. And but you just choose one of these absolute minima. Okay. So here, this is M11. And now you go down. You go down with your saddle values, your separating saddle values, and you look at the set phi smaller than sigma 2. So here, what is sigma 2? You are in 1D, so this is sigma 2. And the set phi smaller than sigma 2 has a certain number of connected components, which are given by, this is one of the connected components, this one and this one. Here there are three connected components. And one of these connected components contains M11, of course. So you forget this connected component, and the other, in the other connected component, you choose, in each of the other connected component, you choose a minimum. So this will be M21, M22, an absolute minimum. Okay, and you go on. Sorry. So this will be sigma 3. You look at phi smaller than sigma 3 and you do the same. So now you look at, you still look at your connected component. There is this connected component, this one, this one, this one, and this one. And you see that this connected component contains already a minimum, this one too, and this one too. So it remains only these two connected components that you label, M31, M33. And if you go to sigma 4, this will be M41. Okay. So this is the way you label the minima, okay? So so this gives you a map sigma which sends any of your minima on the saddle values, and also to each minimum you can associate a connected component. And you will be interested in S is equal to sigma minus phi. Okay, so the generic assumption I was speaking about a few minutes ago is the following. So this is maybe the most technical part of my talk, intricate part of my talk. So what the assumption made by Bouvier-Gerhardt-Klein or Elfer-Kleinier was the following. For all minimum, you assume that phi restricted to E of M has a unique point of minimum. Okay? So when you look at what happened in the connected component, you assume that there is only one minimum. And moreover, you assume that when you look at what happens in the connected component of phi smaller than sigma of M, then if there is some separating saddle point in this region, then this supremum is attained in only one point. Okay, so for instance, this assumption, it's just like this, is not satisfied on this for this potential, just because, for instance, I remember you that this was a component that I label in my procedure, and here there are two minima at the same height. Okay? In some situations, this is satisfied. So this assumption is, for instance, satisfied if you have some potential like this. So the generic assumption is okay here, but it won't be okay for instance. So the typical multiple well like this, GA is not satisfied. Okay. So the fundamental point with this assumption is that this assumption gives you a bijection between the set of minima and the set of separating saddle values. To each minimum, this is this part of the assumption, which tells you that to each minimum you can associate a separating saddle values. And once you can do that, yes?
So for a Morse function, the critical values are separated. So here, are you saying that this is a Morse function, or it's more, it may not be a Morse function, yet you want to...
No, it's a Morse function.
But then the critical values are separated.
Yes, but it's not, yes. And
so
no, but they could be attained by two. Typically, there's in this situation, there is only one critical value, but it's attained by multiple points. Okay, so you want to avoid such multiple such degeneracy. Okay, that's why you have this assumption. And it can be very complicated on Morse functions. Yeah?
So, can you tell us that, why do you expect, like, a priori? Why would you expect that treating that case is harder than treating the case?
Why do I expect that?
A priori, why would you expect that treating that case that doesn't satisfy that is harder than treating the example?
Okay, so, of course, this case may look simple. But treating...
I don't know. No,
I mean, this, it looks simple because this is very constrained. But the point is that in the analysis, so the point is, so it will be, I will try to explain that in a second, but the point is that in the proof, what you do is to reduce your analysis to the analysis of the eigenvalues of a matrix, okay? Finite matrix. And I recall that you are looking for exponentially small quantities. And when you are looking for exponentially small quantities, you want to avoid big errors, okay? I mean, you have to have exponentially small errors. And when you have such multiplicities, it turns out that there may be some errors so things are not well separated. And the error, you don't control the error so easily. Well, it's not very clear what I say. I will try to explain a bit later.
Don't you simply want to say that they are all the same like that?
Sorry?
When you look at the case below there.
This one?
Yes, what's happening is that there's more than one eigenvalue with the same Arrhenius factor.
Yes, for instance.
That's the...
Yeah. A good answer is that in this situation, all the eigenvalues have the same order, the same magnitude. And when you treat eigenvalues with the same order of magnitude, it's difficult just to make the difference between two of them. Okay, it's more difficult than when they are different order of magnitude. Okay, thank you for this observation. Okay. So what is that? Okay, so under this assumption, the theorem of Elfer-Clanier, which was pushed further by Hero et Trichet-Strand, and which is also, I forgot to write it here, the one proved by Bouvier et Gérard-Klein, is that, so this is a more precise statement than the one I gave before, but this is the same theorem. So you have this S of M, which are given by this function S here, and the prefactor zeta of M on H enjoys this very nice expression, okay? So this is given by So this is the eigenvalue so this is given just by the eigenvalues of the Hessian of phi in critical points. Okay. So here's the determinant of in the minimum. Here's the determinant in the associated saddle point, and here one of these eigenvalues. Okay. And of course, in that case, all the value S of M, okay. Okay, so I don't have time to explain the full general case, but I just want to mention what can be done in something like for this potential. But let me look at what happens in 2D, for instance. So assume that this is the level set of your function phi. So the quads are the minima of the function. The O here are some maxima, and here you have saddle points everywhere. And you assume that you are in an analogous situation to this one, that all the minima have the same values and all the saddle points have the same value too. Okay, the phi takes the same value at all the minima, and phi takes the same value at all the saddle points. So then, what I proved is that in that situation, your small eigenvalues enjoy a similar expression. Of course, S, now there is a unique S, which is the common 8 that you have to pass to go from one minimum to the saddle point. And but now the prefactor zeta, so the first term, you still have an asymptotic expansion, and the first term is obtained by computing the eigenvalues of a weighted graph G, capital G. And this weighted graph is the following. The vertices of the graph are the minima M in U0, and the edges of your graph are the saddle points between two minima. Okay. And also, this is a weighted graph, so there are some weights on your graph, but if, for instance, phi second is the same in every minima, every saddle point, this is just a simple graph. So this is the situation. Here is the level set of your function, and this is the associated graph. Okay. So this is a case where you have this type of potential, but actually you can. So what you have to, maybe a more general statement will be that the prefactor zeta k are not given anymore by a simple number, but they are given by the eigenvalues of some matrix which are explicit. But building these matrices may be a bit complicated. There are some induction procedure to construct it, but this is too complicated to. I mean, I don't have enough time to explain this here. Okay, so this is the type of result that we can get. And now let me, in a few minutes, give some idea of how we can prove that. So. Okay, the general strategy of Elfer-Clanier goes back to Elfer and Chostrand is the following. You introduce F0, the eigenspace associated to the N0 small eigenvalues, so on zero forms because you will see later, the associated to your operator. Pi0 will be the projector on F0, and M, the restriction of delta phi on F0. Okay? Of course, the eigenvalues of delta phi are exactly the eigenvalues of M, and you want to compute the eigenvalues of this matrix. Okay, what is your hope is to find a nice basis in which you can compute this matrix, okay, which means a basis that you can construct by hand, and then you can compute by hand the eigenvalues of n. Okay. So, of course, you have the idea is just to take, you remember that you have the so-called approximated eigenfunctions, the quasi-modes. So this FM0, so they are not in the in this space, of course, but if you project it on this space, this gives you element of the this spectral subspace, and you hope that this is a good basis. And actually it could be because A good indication is that these elements that you don't know anymore actually are close to the FM0 that you know. Of course, the advantage of FM0 is that you know it, you have an expression for it. Once you have projected, you don't know anymore what is the FM0. Still, you don't know the subspace. But you have this approximation and you have a good error term. But it turns out that this error term is too big. Okay, and you cannot compute explicitly the eigenvalues of the matrix, expected maybe in the case of a double well or something like that. Okay, so the main tool to overcome this difficulty is to use the so-called supersymmetric structure.
Yeah. So that would mean that whether this works or not, in that case, depends on the number of minima.
Sorry?
It could depend on the number of minima. If you don't have many minima, then you're fine. You
I guess, yes, of course, 2 is okay, because the first eigenvalue is 0, then it will be okay, it will be easy to get the second one. But 3 already is not so clear. Okay. So what is the supersymmetric structure? This is the following. So let denote omega p, the space of p differential forms on RDE, and let d be the exterior derivative. Then you want to introduce the twisted semi-classical derivative. So this is your semi-classical derivative twisted by your weight exponential phi over h. And then the semi-classical Lewitian Laplacian on p forms is defined by this. So this is an operator. So of course, when p equal to 0, these terms is 0. And you recover the Witten-Laplacian I defined at the beginning of my talk. But this actually is defined on one form, two forms, etc. And this gives you an operator. And now, of course, this delta phi on one form has some good properties. You can compute it quite easily. And it shares some similar properties to the Witten-Laplacian on zero forms, and so you can prove that it has exactly n1 element small eigenvalues, where n1 is the number of saddle points. And so I try to accelerate a little bit. This is the second. This is a fundamental observation that you have this intertwining relation, which tells you that when you apply the exterior derivative of p form on the Witten then the Witten Laplacian on p plus one form, it's the same that doing that. Okay. So once you have noticed, so I will do this computation just for you now. Once you have noticed this relationship, tells you that the map d phi 0 maps the set of eigenvalues for the Witten-Laplacian on zero form into the set of eigenvalues for the Witten-Laplacian on one form, simply because delta 1 of d phi of u assumes that d phi, that delta phi u, delta phi on zero form of u equals to lambda u. So this is by my relation given by d phi of delta phi 0 of u. Okay, so this simple relation here tells you that this operator, this delta d phi, sends this space into this one. So now your matrix M can be written like L star L, where L is the matrix of this operator. So now you use your approximated eigenfunction, and the fundamental point here is this lemma, the fine inequalities. So yes, sorry. So now when you want to compute the spectrum of M, this is the spectrum of L star L, which is actually the so-called singular values of L. Okay, and you have the singular values of L, or the eigenvalues of a matrix of the form L star L, enjoy this nice set of inequalities that when you want to compute the singular value of A times B, you have such bounds. Okay. So this gives you, what is important is that it gives you some multiplicative error. So if you think of B being like an error term, so one plus an error term, then you will get some multiplicative error terms here. And this enters in a fundamental ways in the analysis. Okay, so this is a sketch of this approach. And now I have 10 minutes to give you some ideas of what happens. So I will be very fast on the case with boundaries. So sorry, Dorian. So
yes, I have to.
So once you have look at this problem on the whole space, you can ask what happens when you look at the first exit time from a bounded domain. And if you work, so I will be very, will go very fast. If you look at what happens to the dynamic of a particle which starts with some, according to some stationary measure of a bounded domain, then you end up with, to compute the eigenvalues of an operator like this, which can be conjugated to a semi-classical Witten Laplacian on a domain with a boundary. And here, with directly boundary condition, okay? And so such operators have been studied, so first by Elfernier in 06, and by Dorian in his thesis, and more recently in a very big important paper by Digesus, Lelièvre, Lepetrec, and Nectou, where they do a very precise analysis of the spectral theory of this operator. But maybe I think Boris will give some information on this problem in his poster. Okay, so now let me speak a bit about Cramer's Fokker-Planck equation. So you consider this Cramer's Fokker-Planck operator, and you want to do the same. Okay, compute the small eigenvalues. Actually, at the first glance, you don't even know if there are small eigenvalues. Okay, why? Because this operator has two defaults. First, it is non-elliptic because of this part, and second, it is non-self-adjoint because also of this part. Okay, but it turns out that it is hypoelliptic. Okay, but for the moment, we don't know that, and the consequence is that we don't even know the nature of the spectrum of P, and also we don't even know how to go from quasimods to eigenfunctions. Because, for instance, we don't have min-max principle for such operators. Okay, so this operator enjoys this representation, where x0 is just this vector field, and B is just this HdV plus V. And you know that when you want to look at the hypoellipticity, at the regularizing properties of such operators, you have to look at brackets, as it was mentioned in the talks yesterday. And you look at brackets of this part and x0. And when you do that, you have some relations, and one of them implies that if you compute the bracket of x0 on a star b, this gives you a star a plus this part. Okay. And you see, what is important here is, of course, this operator is elliptic in the V variable. The problem is that you don't get, if you want just to prove, for instance, that you have compact resolvance, that you have some pure point spectrum, then you need some ellipticity in the X variable and also some confinement in the X variable. Okay. And you don't have it on this expression. But once you compute this commutator, you obtain this A star A, which is with A given by this expression, and you see A star A is exactly the Witten Laplacian I spoke about just before, and this one is confining and regularizing, okay? This one is elliptic. So when you compute this commutator, you gain some full ellipticity. Okay, so you want to use this relation in the spirit of Hermander's hypoellipticity theorem. And what Hero and Nier proved in the early of the millennium is that you have such estimate. So you introduce this sort of Sobolev scale. So lambda 2 is equal to 1 plus delta phi plus delta of V2 over 2. So this computes the x derivative and v derivative and power of the fixed power of v. and you have the control of of one third derivative by pu and u. Okay, so you have a loss, but you gain some regularity and you gain some confinement. Okay, you gain some confinement if you assume that gradient phi grows sufficiently fast at infinity. And then the consequence of this result is that so if you let epsilon be the minimum of these two quantities, then you have some localization result on the spectrum of P. So let me draw a picture. So what I didn't say is that this operator has, so it is not self-adjoint, but it has its real part is positive, is non-negative. So the spectrum is like this. So you still have zero in the spectrum, and you have some cuspidal region. Okay, so this is real Z, Z equal modulo Z epsilon. And the spectrum is here. Okay, actually it's here actually. And this is, so here is the spectrum. And moreover, if you are away from this region, or for instance, if you are on the boundary, then you have some resolvent estimate. Okay, and this resolvent estimate, combined with some complex analysis, will replace the min-max principle. So this is maybe the main idea, coming back to the work of Shostrand, which is when you are not in a self-adjoint world, you replace your min-max principle or your spectral theorem by complex analysis, okay? By complex analysis and resolvent estimate. Okay, and then if you use this this result, what you see is that you have returned to equilibrium with a weight alpha one, which will be given by the real part of the smallest real part of the eigenvalues that are here, okay?
Zero is on the right.
No, zero is zero.
Ah,
zero is here. Ah, no. N
to z equals z
is
zero,
doit
être sur la courbe.
No, no, but yeah, but no. Because there was a okay, or z smaller than c.
No, but
là, t'as
dit réel de z égale z puissance de epsilon.
Ouais, non, at infinity. Ah. Okay. This is written here. Okay? Okay, okay, 3 minutes. So, what I won't explain today, okay. So, the proof of that is just to write, so the proof is just to write this. Okay, exponential minus tp is equal to the integral of exponential minus tz times the resolvent under on this path. And what you do then is that you change the path of integration. Okay, and you when you do that, when you go from this path of integration to that one, then you have here a pole, and this pole gives you exactly the projection on the pi zero, and the remainder is bounded. What remains is bounded. Here z is bounded from below by some constant alpha, and the fact that the resolvent is bounded tells you that you have no problem. Okay. And the further you can go for z here, so the further you can go here when you change your integration path, the better your estimate is. So this was done in the paper of Hero and Nier, and this is, so this result is universal. I mean, there is no assumption on the temperature. Everything is written in this paper in ARMA in 2004, and everything is explicit with respect to the physical constant. But now, so the idea is, now what is the smallest eigenvalue here? What is the smallest real part here? So, after that, there was a series of work of Hero et Trick-Shostrand, who proved that this, actually, they proved that a similar result to the one obtained in the case of Witten-Laplacian especially that here, excepted that here you are in a non-self-evident world. And what they prove is that there are exactly n0, so you assume that phi is a Morse function, etc., etc. There are exactly n0 eigenvalues in the region 0 real of z smaller than epsilon 0 h. They prove that these eigenvalues are real, actually, so your picture is like this. Here is epsilon 0 h. So in this box, all your eigenvalues are here. They are real. After that, there may be some non-real eigenvalues, but here they are all real, and we can compute it in the same way as we did for the Witten Laplacian, except that now this eigenvalue here is a bit more complicated. It is given by, I mean, you have this matrix here which enters into play. And the proof is complicated. So you have many ingredients, but one of them, which was fundamental in the proof that I sketched before, is the supersymmetric structure. Do you have a supersymmetric structure for your operator? And the answer is yes, you have a supersymmetric structure. Your operator can be written like this, but for a skew product which is non-symmetric. I am almost done. This skew product is non-symmetric, and this has some bad consequences, but anyway, you can introduce a natural operator on one form, you can do some spectral theory for this operator, you can compute these quantities, and at the end, the fact that this skew product is non-symmetric is solved by using some extra symmetry, the so-called PT symmetry, which tells you that your operator behaves nicely when you change the V variable into minus V. Okay, this has some symmetry properties, and when you restrict, when you look at what happens on some spectral subspace, it has some nice consequences. Okay, so yes, just to mention that we are looking now with Frédéric Hérault to what happens in the case of the BGK equation that was mentioned by Anton Arnold yesterday, and we are trying to push these techniques to this case, and maybe the important part will be is that we already got some pseudo-differential supersymmetric structure for this operator, but this is still a work in progress. Okay, sorry for this late, and thank you for your attention.